What's up, everybody? Welcome to System Crafters. I'm David Wilson, and today we're going to talk about how to keep Emacs from moving your windows around. So let me just jump over to the screen real quick. So I think that anyone who has tried to use Emacs for some amount of time has realized that there is sort of an annoying behavior in Emacs to be popping up windows at the bottom of your screen and sort of disturbing the window layout that you've so painstakingly tried to create for whatever it is you're doing at the moment. This is especially a problem whenever you have some kind of workspace setup where you have different workspaces with different window layouts, and you know Emacs comes and trashes the layout whenever you try to open a help buffer or maybe like a Magit status window or anything else like that. So today what we're going to talk about is how to use some built-in functionality in Emacs to control where buffers are displayed or which window they're displayed in whenever the buffer gets opened. Obviously, you could use something like winter mode to get around this issue whenever you have Emacs change your window layout. You can use winter undo basically to undo the window configuration changes, but really it's better if we can make Emacs be a better sort of citizen in our own workflow and make sure that it doesn't put a buffer where we don't want it to be or a window where we don't want it to be. So let's talk about it. So what you really need to understand, and I know there's a lot of text on the screen, so don't get overwhelmed. We're going to go through things step by step. What you need to understand in Emacs is how the display buffer function works, because this is the core function that gets used whenever you are trying to, whenever Emacs wants to display a new buffer. So like say you open a file or maybe a package you use needs to display a buffer of some sort, like a Magit status pane or a help buffer or an org mode document or something like that. Display buffer is what ultimately gets called to decide where that buffer is going to be displayed. So the way that it works is that it consults a series of sources in order, which contain rules for how windows are selected or created to display new buffers. So there are a few of these locations, and we're going to talk about each one one by one, basically, just to describe how it gets used. So first of all, the highest priority one is the display buffer overriding action. And this is a variable that is not used very commonly, and it shouldn't be used by you in your configuration. But basically what it is a way to override any other possible configuration for displaying a buffer. So basically, a package can decide to override the behavior. However, in the documentation for this function or this variable, basically, package authors are discouraged from using this because it is sort of disruptive. What we want from display buffer is a way for the user to configure how windows are either reused or created for the purpose of displaying buffers. So if someone goes and uses this overriding action variable to override that functionality, then users might not be very happy about it. So this is something that should not be used in most cases, but it could be overridden by a package. So something to keep in mind in case maybe display buffer is doing something you don't expect. Next is the display buffer A-list. This is a user-defined buffer placement rule variable. We're not going to discuss this in this video because it gets a little bit more complex, but it gives you fine-grained control over where various buffers that you open get placed in the various windows in Emacs. This is very powerful, and we're going to do a whole separate video on this after we finish this video. Then there's also the action argument of the display buffer function. So if we look at the documentation for display buffer, I'm going to use Control HF here and look for display buffer. Now what it tells us here is that the first parameter to display buffer is the buffer or the name of the buffer we want to display. And then there's an optional parameter called action, and that's basically this thing that we're looking at now. It's basically a way for you to pass in an action to be used to display this buffer. There's also a frame parameter, and this is to say basically which frame you want the buffer to be displayed in. But really for the purpose of this discussion right now, we want to say that whenever someone calls display buffer, excuse me, they can pass in an action, and that's sort of like the third priority in the list of rules that get applied whenever you're trying to display a buffer. Also, there is the display buffer base action. Now, this is the one that you're going to want to know about. Let me just get a sip of water first. So display buffer base action is the user configurable base set of actions to use for placing buffers. We're going to talk about how to configure this in a little bit, but the idea here is that if you want to change the way that Emacs places buffers into Windows by default, this is the variable that you will set first. We will talk about this in detail later. Display buffer fallback action. Now this variable is interesting because it has the list of default placement actions for buffers in Emacs. If you want to know why Emacs places buffers in a certain way, you need to go check out this this variable. And we're going to go through each one of the things in this variable to describe this. So we'll cover this in just a moment. So basically, display buffer builds a list of action functions by gathering the functions from all these different sources we talked about and putting them into an ordered list so that they get tried one by one. So the job of these functions is to return a window to, I think I'm picking up a cold or something, so it's affecting my voice. The function that gets called is going to return a window to use to place the buffer. So display buffer just goes through this list of actions and calls them all, and whenever one of them returns a window to place a buffer, that window gets used to show the buffer. We can also we can test this out by actually calling display buffer ourselves. So for instance, let's say we want to show the scratch buffer. Let's see what the scratch buffer has in it. I think I wrote this wrong. So what we're doing here is calling display buffer. And I think this get buffer create is actually not even necessary. So let me just change this code really quick. So I think what we can do here is call display buffer and pass in scratch. And if I use control X, control E to evaluate this, it's going to, invalid buffer. So let's try, let me just see if the scratch buffer is around and if I called it the correct thing. We'll use get buffer create instead, just in case. All right, so I'm gonna use Control X, Control E. Okay, now, so basically, I think I needed to use Scratch without the stars. Let's try that. Okay, so that's the right one. All right, sorry for that. So now I'm gonna run this again, just so you see one last time how this is gonna behave. And when I execute it, it's gonna pop up a new window below. Now, I didn't tell it to do that. It's just what's already configured in display buffer using some of the variables that we talked about before. Same thing for if we run display buffer get or create test. So we're just basically popping this new buffer up in a new window below. So we're going to be using display buffer to show the effects of the various buffer display action functions while we go through the description here. So first of all, let's talk about what an action function is. Before we talk about the defaults, we're going to describe what they do. So the signature of an action function can be seen here. Basically, it's the the function name, obviously, because we're calling a function. And then the first parameter would be the buffer that we're trying to place. And then the second parameter is an association list that basically has key value pairs to customize the behavior of that function. So display buffer, whenever it calls one of these functions, it's going to pass in the buffer and it's going to pass in this association list that may have either been passed by the user or by Emacs itself to customize the behavior of these action functions. And for those of you who may or may not have seen the Emacs list series we've been working on so far, an association list is basically a list that contains pairs of keys and values so that whenever you want to extract a specific value from that list, you can look for it based on its key. So an example of this would be this list here. And we know this is a list because we have our nested parentheses and this single quote character on the outside, which basically tells us this is a list, or this S expression, or this expression should be treated as a list. We have one pair here, the key mode, and then the period, which sort of denotes that this is a pair. And then the values after this is a list of symbols here, org mode, helpful mode, help mode. And then another pair here for reusable frames, which is bound to T. This list can be used by a display action function to find customizations that need to be used for displaying a buffer in a given window. So let's talk about what keys you might want to use whenever you're trying to pass in an A-list like this. Now, I know that this may seem backwards, like to talk about the possible parameters first, but it's good to know what things are available before we start talking about the various functions that you might want to call for displaying a buffer, or that Emacs might want to call before displaying a buffer. So one of these parameters could be inhibit same window, and it's something that you would pass in an A-list like this to a display function. So this parameter configures whether the currently focused window, like the one we're looking at right now, can or cannot be used for displaying the buffer. If this value is set to nil, the current window can be used because the name of this variable or the name of this parameter is inhibit same window. So inhibit means don't allow the same window to be used. So if we say nil, that means don't inhibit it. So that means it can be used. T in this case means the current window cannot be used. So whenever you're trying to place a new buffer, don't use the window the user's already got their keyboard or mouse focused in. Also, there's reusable frames. This one configures whether the buffer will show up on the current frame, or maybe it could show up on some other frame that's currently open in Emacs. And if you remember a discussion in another video we had, well, let's talk about it out of the context of that. A frame is what your window manager or your desktop environment considers to be a window. So in Windows or in Linux, when you have a window open for a program, that's what Emacs considers a frame. Now, inside of Emacs, there are windows that are that can be displayed. So like when I split this screen in two, these are two windows that are open inside of a single frame. So what we're looking at here is the option for reusable frames. So basically what we're saying is in your desktop environment, in Windows, Linux, macOS, whatever, you may have two Emacs windows open side by side, and this parameter will determine if the buffer that's being opened goes into current frame or maybe any other frame that's open, maybe the frame that you have open next to the current one. All right, so nil means that the value of nil means that you only consider windows in the current frame. T means you can consider any frame that Emacs has open at the moment. The value of visible means consider windows only on the visible frames that you can see, the ones that are not minimized or hidden in some way. Zero means to consider basically any frame, whether it's visible or minimized, which I'm not actually sure why this is different than T, but if somebody knows, definitely let me know in the comments. You can also pass a specific frame object. So I think there's a function called, is it current frame? No, maybe it's get frame. Nope, it's not that either. Anyway, there's a function you can use to get the current frame. There may even be a variable. Let's try that one last time. Current frame. No, it's not there either. Frame. Okay, forget about it. So basically, if you can get a handle on an actual frame object in Emacs, you can actually pass this frame specifically in case you want the window to go to a, or the buffer to go into a window on a specific frame. So this may not be useful to you in all cases, but if you have a multi-frame workflow, or maybe if you're using EXWM or something like that, where different frames represent different high-level workspaces, then this could be useful. Mode is another possibility, which is actually quite interesting for our purposes, which restricts window selection to those displaying buffers of a certain major mode. So basically, if you want all org mode buffers to be opened in the same frame as another org mode buffer that's already being displayed, you can use this mode parameter to do that. You can either pass a single symbol representing a major mode name, or you can have a list of symbols for different major mode names. Like in this case, we're saying mode could be either org mode, helpful mode, or help mode if we want those buffers to be used. I'll show an example of that a little later so that you understand what that means. 1 second, let me actually fix one thing here. So now the next one is inhibit switch frame. And this one sort of goes hand in hand with reusable frames above that I should have kind of moved those there. So I'll just move this really quickly. So basically this prevents a non-current frame, like the one that you're not currently focused on, from being raised or basically have the focus switch to it if the window is placed there only if the value is T. So if inhibit switch frame is T, wait, is that right? If it's nil. Prevents a non-current frame. Okay, T, that's true. Okay, sorry about that. So basically, if inhibit switch frame is set to T in the parameter list, then basically whenever a buffer gets opened in a window on a different frame than the one that's currently there, then it won't make that frame be focused. This could be helpful if you're trying to like display a buffer on another frame, but not switch your current focus in the current frame. There's also window width and window height. This is also a very interesting one where if a window is going to be chosen, it will allow you to say how big the window should be either in width or height whenever the buffer is placed there. So a lot of times whenever you have a buffer get reused by Emacs, it will change the width or the height of it, which is kind of annoying. If you want it to change the width that it would use for selecting a buffer, then you can set one of these parameters to set the width or the height that it would possibly use, or you can say nil so that it does not change the size of the window. That can be pretty helpful if you don't like that behavior where Emacs tries to change the size of the window. There's another parameter that also controls this. I believe it's called same size. I didn't put it here, but it is in this list here. If you go to the Emacs list manual for the buffer display action lists, actually, that's not the right title. Anyway, I think the link goes to the right place if I check it really quickly. Yes, it's buffer display action A lists. That is the actual title for this. So let me just fix this really quickly. So if you go to this list, it will tell you every single possible key value pair that you could put into this list of parameters so that it customizes the function of the display action functions. Now, keep in mind that not every function uses all these settings. Different display action functions will use a different subset of these settings, and you'll need to check the documentation to see which one actually affects the function that you care about the most. So check that documentation page for more details if you want to learn more about that. I just wanted to do kind of a high-level pass over these just so you can see what kinds of things are possible. Because now we're going to go into the list of actual action functions, and you might recognize where some of these things can be used. So I definitely didn't get to cover everything, but it's enough at least to give you an idea of what's there. Okay, so let's take a look at the default placement actions that are used in Emacs. So if you look at the value of the display buffer fallback action variable, if I can use Control HV to look that up, then what it tells us is that this is the default fallback action for display buffer. This is the action used by display buffer if no other actions have been specified. For example, the user options to display buffer A list, display buffer base action, or if they all fail. So basically, this is sort of Emacs' own default behavior. And there is a number of functions here, but I'll show you the list that I have right now that it makes it a little easier to read. So we're going to go through each of these functions individually to say what they do, and you'll understand now why Emacs has the behavior it does when it opens a particular window or buffer. So each of these functions are evaluated in order, like we discussed before. So the first one that actually returns a window is the one that wins, basically, or the one that dictates which window the buffer goes into. So keep in mind, this variable is not intended to be changed by the user. You can change it if you want to, but you shouldn't, because you should use another variable to configure this instead, or another two variables to configure this instead, because you need to have some way for a buffer to be placed even if your custom rules do not apply. Okay, so let's see what each of these actions do. First of all, display buffer maybe same window. This basically wraps the behavior of display buffer same window, so a lot of the same stuff will apply here. So this function uses the function same window p to decide whether the current buffer is the same as the one in another window that's being evaluated. So the display buffer same window function, if you look at the documentation for it, it tells us display the buffer in the selected window. So basically, first of all, what Emacs does is check to see if the current window is a possible target for placing the new buffer. And it uses this same window p, at least the maybe same window function, uses the same window p function to see whether if the buffer that we're trying to place actually belongs in the same window as where the user currently has their focus, basically the selected window. So the same window buffer names and the same window regular expressions lists are both used to determine this. So you can customize these variables to basically say the org agenda buffer should always have another org agenda buffer loaded into the same window, which doesn't really make much sense because you wouldn't have more than one of those with that same name. But basically, you can also use a regular expression to do that check. Frankly, I don't know if this is really that useful. Maybe it is. If anybody has used this and thinks it's a good idea, definitely let me know in the comments. But I think there are other options that are more effective for the same purpose. All right, so if same window P returns T for the given buffer that we're trying to place, it's going to call display buffer same window, which puts the buffer in the currently selected window. But then, yeah, that's basically it. So what we're going to do is try this as an example. We are going to use display buffer. We're going to try to display the scratch buffer, and we're going to pass in a list containing the actions we want to use. In this case, we only want to use the display buffer, maybe same window action function, and we're not going to pass any extra parameters to it, which is what you would see here. We have like the action name and then the dot to say we're pairing this with a list of parameters, and then there's no parameters in the list basically. Also, make sure that your display buffer alist variable and your display buffer base action variables are empty before you try this, because maybe something else would override this functionality. So let's just give it a shot really quick and see what happens. So I'm going to try to run this, and it decides not to display the buffer in the same window because it's not the same window p does not return true in this case. It's asking me for my passphrase now. That's great timing. So then instead, it basically decides to create a new window because since this did not actually work, it goes on to use the fallback actions. So then it picks a different window basically. So let's see. Let's check same window P really quickly and see what the value is for Scratch. So same window P. I'm using meta colon for this to evaluate the string in the mini buffer area. Same window p, let's see, get buffer, I believe is what we want. Yeah, get buffer, scratch, and it returns t, which is interesting. That didn't work as I expected it to. Let me check if it needs to have the asterisks around. That still returns t, but it doesn't return it in the same buffer, which is really interesting. So let me check display, I'm pretty sure I checked this beforehand. Display buffer a list. Taking forever. Okay, still nil. All right, so this one wasn't obviously working the way that I expected it to. Let's move on to the next one, which is display buffer reuse window. Now, I think this is very similar to maybe same window. Actually, no, that's wrong. So the problem with these functions is that the names are different, but don't necessarily seem different enough to distinguish sometimes. So in this case, this function places the buffer in the current window, in the selected window, if it's already displaying that same buffer. So basically, if you're trying to show the same buffer again and it's already displayed in a window, just put focus in the window where it already was. Just display it where it already was. So in this case, let me split this, and I'm going to put scratch down here in this window. And I'm going to use display buffer scratch, and I'm going to use display buffer reuse window here. So if I run this, then we're not going to notice anything happening because it actually displays Scratch down here in the same window that's already open. If we had not had that open and we tried this again, then it's going to pop up a new window for that. So once again, I'm going to use Control X, Control E to evaluate that, and then basically just pops right down. Does keycast work? Let's see, keycast mode. Maybe it'll work if I'm trying to basically make the key bindings I'm using to show up so I don't have to keep saying them. All right, so display buffer. We're gonna use current buffer this time. So the one that we're currently in this window, we're gonna use display buffer reuse window. So I will try to evaluate this, and basically it put the buffer in the same window that we're already in, the one that we're currently looking at and have our focus in. However, what if we want to say display the current buffer and tell display buffer reuse window to inhibit the same window? So like we talked about before, inhibit same window. I think we talked about that, didn't we? Anyway, inhibit same window will keep the current window from being used whenever we are picking where to put the new buffer. So let's see what happens if I do that. If I use Control X, Control E, then it puts the buffer down in the window below, because we basically said, don't use the same window that we're currently in, use a different window. Just pick some other window, basically. So that's what it did. It put that buffer down below because we don't want to use the same window. So this is the first time we've seen inhibit same window be used, but it could be used in any of these functions, I believe, because it's a pretty basic setting to be used. Now there is display buffer maybe pop up frame or window. This creates a pop up frame or window depending on whether the pop up frames or pop up windows variables are non-nil. The default is for pop up windows to be set to true and pop up frames to be set to false, because typically speaking, people don't necessarily want a new frame to be opened every time you open a buffer. However, if for whatever reason you do want that, you can set pop-up frames to true, and instead of popping up a new window, it will pop up a new frame whenever you open something like a help buffer or something. I don't want to demo that right now because it's going to break EXWM, but we can see that it will pop up a new window in this case. So, oh, there we go. Keycast showing up now. All right, so what we'll do is run this example here. And so what this maybe function is doing, and I should also mention, because probably you've seen it and you're wondering why it has these two hyphens here. These two functions with two hyphens between some section usually mean this is a function that, or a command that's not meant to be used directly by the user. So these maybe functions are used internally in Emacs, basically to have extra behavior that gets added that's conditional based on when certain things are true or false, basically. In this case, this maybe function is checking pop-up frames, excuse me, and pop-up windows. And if one of those is true, it's going to call a different function. So if pop-up frames is true or non-nil, the display buffer pop-up frame function will be called. Likewise, when pop-up windows is non-nil, display buffer pop-up window will be called. So you can use those two functions directly if you want to, but by default, this maybe function is being used internally in Emacs. So let's go to the end here and use Control X, Control E to evaluate this. And we see that a new window is popped up for the scratch buffer because we have pop-up windows is set to true. However, if we were to use the mini buffer to evaluate set queue pop-up windows to be nil, and we try to run that again, it will open it in the same window because we told it not to try to pop up any windows. So that's another way you can control whether pop-up windows are being displayed at all, is to basically set this value to nil. So I'm gonna go back and set that to T. All right, so display buffer in previous window. Now this one has an interesting name, and it's not exactly what you might think. So it places the buffer in a previously used window for that buffer. So basically, if the buffer has ever been displayed in another window that's currently visible on the screen, it will pick that window instead of the current one. So let's say we want to have scratch here in this window. So I'm gonna put scratch here, then I'm gonna go right back to displaybuffer.org. Now, what has happened here is Emacs will remember that I just opened Scratch in this window previously. And if I were to try to open Scratch again by using display buffer on the Scratch buffer and also say display buffer in previous window, Control X, Control E, it's going to open it here in the current window because that's the last place where it was used. However, if I were to go down to this window, open up the Scratch buffer, and then go back to, let's say, a different buffer. Let's say this emacs12.org. And I run it again with Scratch. Then it's going to show it in the bottom window. So basically, if you want a workflow where if you have a certain frame that's showing a certain type of buffer and you put them there, and you want to make sure that whenever you open that buffer again through some other means that it goes back to that same window, then you definitely want to use this function in your configuration. You can say to inhibit the same window. So if, for instance, the current window you're in was the last place where that buffer showed up, but you don't want it to show up there, you can also customize it to say inhibit same window, and then it will show up in a different window. So let's say I switch to Scratch in this window. I'll go down and switch to Emacs 12 here. Now here I'll go back to the display buffer org file. I'll use Control X, Control E to evaluate this, and now the buffer will show up in the bottom because we're trying to inhibit the same window from being used for placing this buffer, even though it was the previous window in the same for the same buffer. Okay, so display buffer use some window. Basically, find any usable window to place a buffer. Now we're getting to the end of the list of default actions. So basically, if all else fails for whatever reason, then we're just going to say pick whatever window that we can find, I mean, whatever window that's actually usable. So mostly recently used windows would be a thing. So maybe if you had, like five windows and maybe you use one of them more recently than the others, that might be the one that gets picked. But it skips any dedicated windows. That's a topic we really haven't covered yet on the channel. But basically in Emacs, you can set a particular window to have a dedicated purpose, and then it won't use that window for placing buffers. It will only keep the current buffer that you have set there. So this is sort of like a general use case function, and probably in most cases it won't get called because some other action function above it will get there first. And lastly, display buffer pop-up frame. If we really get to a point where we can't place that buffer in the current frame in one of the windows, it will just create a new frame. So that's like really last case scenario, I think. And I'm not going to run this one too because I don't want to break EXWM. All right. So there are other placement actions aside from the ones that are there by default, and some of them are actually quite useful for various purposes. So we're going to cover just a couple of them really quickly to get a sense for them. So display buffer reuse mode window. Now, what this does is, which is pretty useful, is allows you to reuse a window that's already showing a buffer with one of the major modes that you've asked for it to share, basically. So like I mentioned before, you could have it set up so that all org mode buffers go to a particular window on the screen if there's already an org mode buffer being displayed there. So this really does require that the mode parameter be provided to say which modes this applies to. I think it doesn't really work unless you do this. And in this case, we're going to have an example where we are displaying the helpful command. Oh, that's interesting. I think that I know why things weren't displaying correctly now. I think the emphasis markers are being hidden here. The asterisk actually is here. Side note, sorry. So display buffer is calling. So we're trying to display the buffer for helpful command special lispy clone. So this is a help buffer I've already opened at some point, and we're going to show it again. But we're going to use display buffer reuse mode window, and we're going to use helpful mode. We're going to say for any helpful mode, which is a package that I use for showing help buffers, for any helpful mode buffer, if there's already a window with a helpful mode buffer being displayed, use that. Otherwise, just pick another window. So I'm going to split these here, and then in this buffer, I'm going to just use Control-HV to look at, let's say, keycast mode variable. Actually, let's move that here, keycast mode. Okay, and in this buffer, we're going to go back to where we were before. Now, so what we're going to do is we're going to open the existing buffer that I already have open that you just can't see right now, called special lispy clone. It's a help buffer for that function. And we're going to tell it to reuse a mode window for helpful mode, which means it should reuse this window in the bottom right hand corner. I'm going to go to the end of this expression. I'm going to use Control X, Control E to evaluate it. And like we expected, it shows up down here in this corner. However, if I get rid of both these buffers here and then try to evaluate it again, the window shows up right here instead. And that's because there isn't already a window with a helpful mode buffer open. So it just picks the first one that it can using some other rule, basically. Let's see. The same thing applies for other modes. If you want to use multiple modes to configure this behavior, just put more modes in this list here, like org mode, help mode, any other mode that you really care about. You can even do language modes if you want to for that purpose. I think it's a pretty useful command. There's also a display buffer inside window, which is kind of cool because you can say that a buffer should go to one of the sides of the current frame, basically. So let's say we don't pass any parameters to it. We just say, I want Scratch to be in a side window. I believe it picks the bottom by default. And when I run that, it will pop up a small window in the bottom of the frame to show that buffer that we just added here. You can be more explicit here, actually, and say side bottom, in this case, side dot bottom. And it will do the same thing. Oh, actually, in this case, it didn't want to do it. Oh, I don't have enough parentheses. Here we go. There we go. So it opened it in the bottom. But you can also open on other sides as well. Like, let's say we want to open up on the right side. If you set the side parameter to right and evaluate that, it will open it up on the right side. Similarly, you can open it up on the left. And then also, you can set the width or the height of the window that gets opened by saying window width or window height as another parameter in that A list that gets passed into display buffer. So I can use Control X, Control E to make that be a 15 character wide window that gets open. And then also here, if I evaluate this, it opens a window at the top that's only 5 characters tall. So we have a lot of control over the size and placement of these windows when we want to open them to the side. This can be useful if you want help windows to open to the side, or maybe you want org mode buffers to open to the side. This is something that you can use for that purpose. Display buffer at bottom is kind of like a generalization of this. Not a general, it's like the opposite. Basically, a specialization to basically say always display the buffer at the bottom. I think that the other option of display buffer and side window is a lot more flexible, so it's kind of better for that use. But if you want just a simple option, display buffer at bottom can work for you as well. And then lastly, Display buffer no window will basically make the window not display at all. However, it does require that the allow no window parameter to be set to true in this case. So if I go to evaluate this and try to show the scratch buffer, it actually won't show because I'm telling it not to show that buffer at all. So it just returns nil in that case. So this can be a good fallback in case you don't want a window to show up for some reason. Like maybe it should show up in one case, and if it doesn't show up there, just don't show it at all. That's a possibility that you could use there. I don't know how often people would use that though. So if you found a way to use this, definitely let me know because I would be curious to hear about it. And there's really a lot more functions like this built into Emacs already to give you this behavior so that you can customize how buffers are placed. You should go check out this link that I have here to the buffer display action functions in the Emacs Lisp manual to learn more about all those possibilities. I can't possibly cover all of them because this video would be an hour and a half long. So let's just continue on with what we got here. All right. So now we're finally to the point where we can decide how we want to override the default buffer placement actions in Emacs. So as we mentioned before, the display buffer fallback action variable is not meant to be set by you. The one that you should set is display buffer base action. So if we look at the documentation for that one with control HV, it will tell us when it finally loads that by default, this is a list containing nil. So it's got no items, basically. It's the user specified default action for display buffer. So this is supposed to be a pairing of a list of functions and an A list of default variable settings for this list of functions. So the simplest case is basically you just give it a list of functions, or basically a list of lists in this case, to say which functions you want it to use instead of those fallback actions that were being used before. So this is basically where you can say, I want you to reuse the same window for the buffer, or I want you to reuse the same window for a particular mode, or use the same window that was currently being used, or use the previous window where the buffer gets displayed. So any of these possibilities. And this is how we can get rid of that behavior where Emacs is going to be popping up windows. And I guess, as we saw before, you can just set pop-up windows to nil. But I think this is a much more flexible and customizable approach for doing the same thing. So now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to evaluate this to set display buffer base action. And then I'm going to try to get a help buffer to show up. So I'm going to use control HF. And then I'll pick anything here. So yeah, let's just say display buffer reuse mode window, press enter. And then it puts it into the same window that we're already looking at. So we're not seeing that pop up at the bottom anymore like we used to. Let me pull up two things side by side here and try that one more time. So I'm gonna try to use control HF and then pick another function. In this case, it put the help buffer into that other window where it was already set, or it was already visible. I can also resize this window and then try that one more time. Let's say control HF and then use maybe enable theme. And we'll see that the help buffer does not have its size changed. So already we're at a point now where we have more control over how our windows are being used and whether they're being like new windows are popping up or being resized or whatever. That doesn't happen anymore because we have more control. We've set it exactly how we want it to be set. If we want a little bit more granular control over some aspects of this, you can actually use an A list here. So we're basically, we have this list of functions here for the possible list of actions, but we also have this dot to pair it with the A list for the parameters we want to send to all of these functions. So this list of parameters will get sent to every one of these functions in this list. So it's not like you can customize it per function. You would use display buffer A list for that, and we'll talk about that another time. But this is at least at the top level a set of settings that gets used for all of these functions. So if you wanted to set that inhibit same window or reusable frames or whatever, you can set that here to customize the behavior of these functions further. So what we're going to do here is set up the reuse mode window so that org mode, helpful mode, and help mode buffers get their windows reused, but any other buffer wouldn't get reused in the same way. So I can evaluate that, and let's put let's put any other kind of buffer here. So let's put the scratch buffer there. And let's see, what else can we do? Got any other type of buffer that's not the same? We can put this fundamental mode buffer there maybe. So what if we try to open up, that's another scratch buffer. Whatever, that's fine. So we'll open up a help buffer and it comes up in this window. Now it came in the same window as we expected, but it didn't go to the same window as another fundamental mode buffer because we didn't actually add fundamental mode or Lisp interaction mode as one of those buffers that gets reused, basically. So that's how you know that. I would have to open one that's the same mode. So let's actually open another fundamental mode buffer. So let's see. If I were to go back into my org file, this may be a failed example because I didn't actually prepare correctly for it. I apologize for that, but let's just look at it anyway. So if I were to open up, let's put Scratch, that's fundamental. Okay, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna go use one of these other display buffers that we had before. If I can exit my presentation, I can jump up here really quickly and grab this one example that I had of, yes, display buffer, get buffer create test. All right, so test with an exclamation point also is a fundamental mode buffer. This window here is fundamental mode, but if I try to evaluate this, then it's not going to open it in the same window because we don't say that fundamental mode is one of those modes where you can get it to show up in the same window. However, if we go here and open up a help buffer, and then if I were here and use Control HF, and then I'm in the left window right now, just in case that wasn't clear. Control HF, and then I'll pick one of these functions. Then that one actually will show up over whenever it finally loads and displays help. It will show up in the right-hand pane because it is set up to have its mode be reused in another window. So that's just to show you that you can have that control over the default settings without having to have too much of a complicated configuration. You basically just set the display buffer base action variable, and then you give it the list of the action functions to use that you care about, and also the list of parameters, if there are any that you want to use to customize those functions. And then that basically works for any buffer that gets displayed. Now, let's talk about what's next. Let me see if I can pull my presentation back up. Org present. Okay. So what's next? So in the next video, we're going to do another video on this, maybe even a third video, depending on how it goes. But what we're going to do is we're going to go even deeper and figure out how to customize buffer placement at a per buffer level. So right now, these functions we've configured are applied to every buffer that gets open. But maybe we want certain buffers to have a different list of functions that gets used to try to place those buffers whenever they get opened. So you can use the display buffer A-list variable to configure this. And since it's a little bit more complex, we're going to talk about that in a separate video so that we have time to actually cover all of that. And what we're also going to do is try to write our own custom display action function to have even more control over where a buffer would be displayed. So one example of this is if you're using EXWM, maybe you want that buffer to be put on a specific workspace. So we can write a custom function that does that for us, and we're going to see that in another video. Hopefully that was useful to you. I hope it wasn't too complex and not straightforward enough. So if you had trouble understanding what I was showing here today, definitely leave a note in the comments and let me know what you thought about it. Also, if the video was helpful for you, please like the video because that helps the YouTube recommendation engine show this video to other people, and that'll be really helpful for the channel. So if you want an easy way to help the channel, please definitely like the video. Okay, lastly, I would just like to say thank you to my sponsors. And once again, this sponsor screen is severely out of date. We've got a lot more sponsors since this last update of the screen. I apologize to new sponsors. I will get to that very soon tomorrow, I hope. So anyway, these people have decided to help sponsor the content that I'm creating on this channel about Emacs and Linux, etc. And I'm very thankful to them for deciding to do so. Honestly, it's basically what keeps me going whenever the times get tough and it's really hard to make the next video. I just think about, you know, wanting to continue doing this for my sponsors who have been so grateful, or who I'm so grateful to for having signed up to do this for me. If you're interested in becoming a sponsor for the channel and to support the content that I'm creating, definitely check out the two links below. I'm on both GitHub sponsors and Patreon. And I also have a link to PayPal if you want to do a one-time donation. So whatever you want to do is great. But anyway, just watching the videos and being a part of this community is also really good. I really appreciate every one of you who watch these. So anyway, until next time, I'll see you all on Friday for the next live stream. And then after that, we'll have some more videos. As always, until next time, happy hacking. Thanks a lot for watching.